Welcome to the Grok Shop and part 3 in my series on compost tea. In this video, I'll discuss and test some possible ways you can prepare your water to make compost tea. If you have collected rainwater or untreated well water available to use, good for you. You don't need to watch this video. You might want to move on to part 4 in the compost tea series. But if you're like me and most other schmoes, you're going to be on city water, and water authorities will add chlorine and chloramine to the water to eliminate human pathogens. They call it treating the water, and it does help kill a lot of nasty microorganisms. Unfortunately, it also kills good microorganisms, which is what we're trying to grow and harvest with the compost tea production. Here you can see I'm using a cheap pool test kit from Home Depot. They call it the HDX brand. But you can get many other versions of this, but they work pretty good for measuring chlorine, total chlorine, and free chlorine. And as you can see, I start out with about 2 parts per million and try to work my way down to 0. You can also use test strips. I'll show how to use those later in this video. But whatever you use, it's a good idea to get a good understanding of where you're starting at. Once you get a process down, you really don't have to test anymore. You just stick to your process, because generally the water authorities don't change their formulas too much. One big exception to that would be the fact that a lot of water authorities are switching to chloramine from chlorine. And chloramine is basically when the chlorine molecules combine with other molecules like ammonia, and that causes the chlorine to be more stable in the water. It lasts longer and they get more mileage out of their chlorine that way. So in this first test, I'm just letting the water sit indoors, and you can see over a period of 3 days, it just barely drops tiny amounts each day. And I'm still sitting at about, I think, 1.7 parts per million here after 3 days. So this is pretty much a non-starter. I need the water dechlorinated and de-chloramated much faster than this. Okay, so now test 2 will be having the water sit outside in full sun all day under the UV rays. UV radiation is definitely a catalyst for breaking down those chlorine and chloramine molecules. So we'll test it in the morning and in the evening after about 3 days and see what happens here. So yep, each test starting out is straight out of the tap, and I estimate it's around about 2 parts per million. So as you guys probably know, carbon filters are great filters for chlorine and chloramines. Definitely make sure you have one on your home water if you're going to be drinking it. A lot of beer brewers would use carbon filters in the past, and my understanding is a lot of them are switching over to UV radiation because it's just so much more cost effective for them. Now, a curious phenomenon I noticed during these tests is the big drops in chlorine and chloramine as measured with this tester occurred the following morning after it had been sitting out all day. So my theory there is the bonds are being broken down during the day by the UV radiation, and then after they're broken down, they continue to gas off overnight, and perhaps the majority of the gassing off or evaporation is occurring after the bonds are broken during the day. But I'm not a chemist, so if anybody knows that I'm wrong there on that count, let me know in the comments below. So one important question you're probably asking yourself is, how much chlorine is too much chlorine for making compost tea? And the answer to that is probably a little bit nebulous and depends on, you know, a number of factors. For me, for now, I drive it all the way to zero or very close to zero, as far as I can tell from these cheap testers I use. But it probably doesn't need to be all the way to zero. And the reason for that is because when you're dealing with compost and humic acid and fulvic acid and all these organic molecules that are found in and around compost tea, you're going to have kind of like the wind to your back, so to speak. The compost tea itself will work to break down some of these chlorine molecules. And so the answer is I don't know. I try to make mine zero for now, and I have a process for that. But if it's 0.5 parts per million or something, it may not be a problem. But for sure, 2 parts per million is a problem, because that's what the water authority thinks is enough to kill microorganisms. So I know it needs to be way less than that. So after 3 days sitting outside, the chlorine's driven all the way to zero. And another thing I figured out, a big advantage of doing it outside, would be you know, all the gases that come off, the ammonia, the chlorine, while not super concentrated, really harmful unless you have your head over the bucket all day, at least they're outside and they're out of the way. But one disadvantage would be I saw a lot of evaporation. It's pretty hot here where I am right now and dry, so that probably increased it. I reckoned about a couple liters of water evaporated. Fortunately, I had another can of water that's been sitting outside, and I'm testing here to make sure it's chlorine free, which it is. And I can replenish my lost water that way. But it's probably a good idea, if you're going to use the outside techniques, to have an extra bucket. And you might want an extra bucket anyway for diluting your compost tea and whatnot. So here I'm going to go ahead and test the pH of the water. The pH level definitely affects chlorine and chloramine breakdown, and the chemical reactions kind of go both ways depending on the pH levels of your water. I'm not really going to get into all that here. Just wanted to point out that you can test it with this kit. It's good to know your pH for producing compost, as well as for how to amend your soil, and depending on what kind of plants you're growing, different plants, you know, may prefer more acidic or more alkaline conditions. And sometimes you can use your pH level of your water as a guide on how to amend your growing medium, your water, and whatnot to get the results you want. So yeah, our water is pretty alkaline, as well as the soil. So we're constantly in a bring the pH level down mode when we're trying to grow things. One way to get pH levels sort of under control, and as well break down chloramines in the water, is to use humic acid. And there's been some research done that shows you can add 1 teaspoon of humic acid to 100 gallons to eliminate chloramines from the water. And presumably that's 100% humic acid, and this is 8%. So if this was 5%, it would be 1 teaspoon per 5 gallons. So This is 8%, a little stronger, so I use a little less than a teaspoon per 5-gallon bucket. Now, one thing to be aware of is when you use compost, compost will typically already have humic acid in it. It's hard to know the levels and whatnot, so this is really sort of optional. Sometimes I'll add it before I start my compost tea if I think the chlorine's not quite completely gone. So back to the testing, this third and final test, I'm doing an outside bubble. So it's basically going to be the same as test two, except I'm adding the compost tea bubbler into the mix to see if this will speed things up at all. Remember, it took 3 days to go all the way from 2 to 0 in that test. So now, one thing definitely to be aware of is you may or may not have chloramines in your water, and if you have no chloramines but only chlorine and what they call free or residual chlorine, then you might be able to dechlorinate much faster. The chloramines are much stickier and difficult to get rid of than free and residual chlorine. You can usually tell this by looking at your water report for your local water authority. I definitely did that, as well as calling them, and I know for sure that they're using chloraminated water where I live. So yeah, here we go. After 24 hours, we can see the chlorine levels are all the way to zero. So this is definitely going to be the preferred technique for the fastest dechlorination. I would say outside bubbling in the sun for the win. Okay, so besides the chemical test kit, like what I've been using, you can also use the strips. This one here tests total chlorine, free chlorine, pH, and total alkalinity, and it's pretty accurate. I find it is about as accurate as the chemical test kit. They're all based on a color decode wheel system, and the strips are pretty cheap. They're cheaper than the chemical kit by a bit. And I think I paid $11 or $12 for this one. I'll put some links to these below, and also to something similar to the pool test kit I've been using. This bottle contains 100 test strips, which is probably more than you'll need, because once you have your system down and you understand your chlorine levels, you really don't have to test it all that much. And you can see it agrees with the chemical test kit. I got about 2 parts per million total chlorine and pretty much 0 free chlorine. That is one advantage of the test strips. They break out the free and total, whereas with the chemicals, at least the one I have, it's just based on time. When you first put the drops in, it's supposed to be free chlorine, and then after a couple minutes, it's supposed to be total chlorine. That sounds a little fuzzy to me. They definitely do make more accurate test kits that you can get, which will really break down the levels very accurately as far as free and total chlorine and other parameters. But then you got to decide, you know, how much do you really want to spend for making compost tea, right? So yeah, as you can see, the test strips show pretty much zero chlorine after 24 hours, just like the chemical test did. But just to be sure, I'll go ahead and run the chemical test on the same water. Both tests agree, it's time to make some tea. So here's a summary bullet list of some of the highlights. You guys can check that out at your leisure. That's how it's done. Thanks for watching.